5 years and still talking, this is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Hey, hey everybody, this is Alex Bennett and this is the Ramble. We go until midnight. Yes, we do.
All right, here we go once again. Into the breach, dear friends. Into the breach. Let's make a call out to Las Vegas and see what happens here. We got to wait for it to. It's starting to ring. Yeah, it's starting to ring. And we'll see what happens here. If he picks up. Come on, pick up, my friend.
I told you never to call me when I'm watching Lancer. And our TV obscure references for today, Lancer.
Lancer. Do you remember
Lancer?
Do you remember Lancer?
A couple of times. I think my father used to watch it as a Western or something.
Yeah.
In color on CBS.
Yeah. They used to make a big deal about In Color.
In Color. That's right.
Yeah. Yep. Anyway, how are you doing, Stephen Pearl?
Good on this wonderful hump day today.
And this wonderful
December
hump.
Already. My God, the time just zips by.
Wow. Yeah. So, how you doing?
All right, just still alive, you know, there you go. So, ready for another year.
As long as you're above room temperature, everything
is exactly.
Fine.
Yes, exactly. That's what I know. As long as you got a pulse, every day is a good day. That's what they say. That's what they be telling me.
Yeah. If you got the pulse, you got it. Yeah, I just, you know, today, this is going to be played not on it, but we're recording it on it. This is my 80th birthday today.
Happy birthday. Jesus, you made the big 8-0. How about that? Not too many people can say that.
Yeah.
It's all downhill from here.
Yep, it sure is. Well, you know, it's kind of like you're 80 and you go, oh, isn't that amazing? And everybody applauds. And the answer is I didn't have to do anything to reach 80. I just had to not die, you know.
Had to not die, that's all. Not that hard.
You know, so I'm sorry, but I can't take any claim to any ability at doing anything except keeping on breathing.
It's a milestone.
Yeah.
To reach a milestone, you just have to not die. So stay alive and you'll reach that milestone.
But at least I've got something now that I can depend on as a infirmity or whatever. You know, this prostate cancer. So, you know. But then they'll cure that and I'll have nothing to gripe about anymore.
There you go. You're alive forever. Who needs that?
Yeah. But will you come to the funeral?
No, I'll be there, sure.
Yeah.
Try to have it in Vegas, though. I don't have the train.
See, that's the problem. I figure if I die tomorrow, I think one person would show up to my funeral. Two. Two if you include my wife, but if she's busy, you know.
Yeah.
Might not be the case, but whatever. So,
yep. What are you going to do? He won't be there. What do you care?
That's right. I have no big deal being there, and I will be there.
Well, part of you will be there. Somewhere else, or nowhere. What do I know?
Kind of lying there, you know.
As George Carlin said, when you die, your soul goes to a garage in Buffalo.
Did he say that?
One of my favorite lines ever.
Yeah. It's you know, you go, what the hell, you know?
What the hell? Still here another day. What the fuck?
Well, it's just nothing. I have nothing, you know, I had all these wonderful adventures in life, and now I don't have any adventures anymore.
Yeah,
so
that's true.
My biggest adventure, is this whole situation with the cancer and the the science fiction-like solution they have to my problem, which is radiation, okay? Well, no, that's not an oy vey, because it's really – they have this – like, first radiation I have to do is a thing called the cyber knife, okay? Mm-hmm. It's not a knife. It's just – they call it cyber knife. I don't know who came up with that name for it, but it sounds so deadly. It should be like cyber whatever. Anyway, it's just radiation, right? But what they do is I've got my doctor sedates me, and then he puts three gold things in my prostate, which are used to aim the radiation.
Uh-huh.
You know? So I will have gold in my prostate, right? So then they've got this machine, and I've seen it. If you go online, it's like something out of science fiction. I mean, it's just it just goes, you know, does its thing. It circles and it goes around, and it goes, then it goes zap, and then you go home. And then you come back 2 days later, and they go zap again, and you do this for any number of times, and before you know it, you're after five of them, you're through with that. Then I wait a little bit, and then I have another operation where they put me under for an hour, and they stick radioactive seeds in my prostate.
Jeez.
Now, how science fiction is that?
This is the future.
You know.
It's amazing.
They'll be able to find me, you know.
Yeah.
By just my radioactive signature. So, that's what it's all about, and I'm sticking to it.
Science marches on. Da, 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 da.
Yeah. So, anyway, that's what's happening.
Ah, well, we all wish you the best over here.
Well, that's my great adventure, is what I'm saying.
Alex's great adventure.
And I'm kind of looking forward to it. There are side effects, but I'm looking forward to it because it's so science fiction-like. You know, imagine I'll be walking around with some radioactive seeds in my prostate. I can't get near babies.
Well, lucky you.
They say there's a whole rule they have where you can't get near babies.
Stay away from babies. You'll be you'll be glowing.
Yeah.
Stay away from those babies. You can't be a politician. Don't kiss any babies.
Right, exactly. So, you know, what have you. That.
What can you do? What can you do? Another day at the beach.
Well, what can we talk about that's happy? Well, that's it for this. what can we talk about that's happy? Well, you're how old now?
What's that?
How old are you now?
I'm 64. November 16th, I turned 64.
Oh, you know, you're creeping up on Social Security.
I know. Another couple of years, if I make it. My luck, the day before I turn 66, I get hit by a falling piano, but we shall see.
Yeah, well, I'm just figuring maybe we should, you know, do a whole thing with just the Alta Kaka comedians.
Yeah. All the old farts, the new faces of 80. New faces of 62.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I you know.
Well, as I said, I'm Steve McQueen at the end of Poppy, and still shaking my fist at the ocean. I'm still here, you bastards.
Yeah, still here. Still here.
Still here.
Yeah.
Still here.
Yeah.
Still performing. God knows why.
Yeah. Do you get tired of performing at all?
Sometimes, yeah. Especially when it comes, I got to drive, get to the gig, and blah, blah, blah. You know, it's just, I like being up there, but getting to the gig is what I figure I'm getting paid for. I'll do the gig for free. You got to pay me to get to the gig.
Yeah.
So it's fun. It's just, you know, at this age, I really enjoy being home with the cats and the weed and the computer and the TV and everything. So, you know, to leave the house is a little bit of a chore. So,
yeah.
I'm old. I deserve my stay-home time.
Yeah. Now, it's funny. All of us are getting old. I mean, this is really, really strange that all these people that I had on my show who at the time were kids. Okay.
Yeah, that's right.
And I said,
right. I was in my 20s.
Yeah. Yeah, and I was in my, I guess, 60s or something like that. I mean, it was
big.
But
that's right. I mean, God, I met you like 40 years ago, 80 or something. Holy crap.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah. So, I mean, all these people that we know have gotten older, and some of them have even had strokes, you know?
That's right. Some of them had strokes. Some of them aren't here anymore. So, you know, it's just the way of life. You got to deal with it.
Well, what can we
go by this path?
Let's get very depressed here. Name a list of comedians that you knew who are now dead.
Oh, my God. Okay. Well, there's Gil Christner. There's Lorenzo. There's Robin. There's who's the other one? Kevin Meaney. There's I can go on forever, and I think I will.
Well, you forgot Sam Kinison, you know.
Sam Kinison, definitely. Bill Hicks, the new Bill. I was in a movie with him.
Right.
Who else is dead? Let's see. No, I didn't know Shanley. I met Belushi a few times. He's gone, but he took the early train out.
See what I'm saying?
Who else?
See what I'm saying? If we'd had this discussion 20 years ago, you couldn't name any.
No, I couldn't name anybody. Now the list goes on and on and on.
And then, you know, we have somebody like Will Durst, for instance, who had a stroke.
Yeah, that sucks.
You know, that sucks.
That totally sucks, huh?
Yeah. And I think I read somewhere. I mean, I talked. I communicate with Debbie all the time via text. But I read an article where he just said, "Well, I guess my comedy career is over." You know,
hey, sucks. We saved some money or something. I don't know what the deal is.
Well, he is a writer, and if he can still type, then he's still got a profession. You know.
Yeah, I hear his mind is still working. He can still make the thoughts. He just has to. Yeah.
Well, that has got to be a terrible thing, is to be able to have the thoughts, but not be able to do anything with them. You know?
Yeah, that was the problem with Richard Pryor. He had the MS. He could still, you know, he could still have the thoughts, but his body couldn't paint the picture anymore, which totally sucks.
Yeah. Yeah. Because in comedy, your tool is your voice.
Exactly.
And your body.
Yep.
You know.
Yep. If I lost my voice, I'd be out of a job. I'd be, you know, oh, man.
Yeah. So anyway, so I that one really depresses me. So I go, well, I've only got prostate cancer, which is quite curable, you know.
Or
maybe it isn't curable. Maybe it'll kill me eventually. I don't know.
Yeah.
But we all have something bad going on.
We're all on the hit list, baby. We're all going to go sooner or later.
Yeah.
If everybody's name is on the hit list, so you know, just got to deal with it.
If anybody wants my advice on how you get to 80, I don't have any.
You either make it or you don't. That's all.
Yeah, you either make it.
Look at Keith Richards. People who live real healthy drop dead in their 40s, and then there's Keith Richards. So
there's no rhyme
or reason or fairness to it.
That's the one I can't figure out. You look at Keith Richards, and he looks 10 days dead. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, he looks like an old oak tree. You're right.
That's savvy, though. Looks like an old tree. Your initials and Keith.
He just keeps going. This is a guy who has so ravaged his body. And how old is he now? Do you know?
74, I believe. Today's his birthday, December 18th.
Oh, really?
74.
Okay, so I have the same birthday as Keith Richards.
You got the same birthday as Keith Richards, that's right.
How about my same birthday as Steven Spielberg?
Not bad, not bad.
I'm 2 days away from being the same age as Beethoven.
Okay.
I mean, when I was younger, I looked to see who had my birthday, and of course, none of these people, like, you know, Spielberg or Keith Richards existed at the time.
They wouldn't list that in the almanac back then.
Yeah. But, I mean, it was something. It was something.
Yeah.
Anyway, so whenever we're playing this, whether it's a day after my birthday or on my birthday, I guess this is all appropriate. And I just don't know how I got this old. I mean, and I all the things
you just did. You didn't die for 80 years. That's what happened.
Well, also,
you lived.
I look at all the years that have passed and what went on in those years, and it kind of like makes me it weirds me out a little bit. Yeah. Oh, there goes your phone. Or is that my phone?
Hello.
You know something? My wife always calls me. I'll decline.
Right when you're on the air. Yeah, sure.
While I'm on the air. That's what that was, folks. That was my wife calling me. She always I always tell her, don't call me between 1 and 1:30. That's usually when I'm doing an interview.
And they do. Yeah.
And she calls me, you know. So what the hell?
Yeah. Just like a woman, just like a broad, ain't it? Just like a broad.
Yeah. So what are you listening? You know, you always, when we talk to you about music, which you are an expert on.
I love the music. I love to have the notes around me.
You love the music.
The
other day, my wife said to me, I hear rap, and it goes in one ear and out the other. It's just kind of like ambient.
Yep.
Do you have any respect for rap music?
I don't like it myself. You know, somebody who can make millions of dollars out of it, be my guest. If society is sunk that low. But, no, I don't really like it. It doesn't do a thing for me. And I understand in some ways it's today's blues, people talking about what's going on around their neighborhoods and in their lives and all that stuff. But it doesn't do a thing for me. And if you're going to play your rap music, keep going by my house.
Well, you know, one of the things I used to – what I said about it was it's kind of, if you think about it, folk music.
Yeah.
Because – they're all telling stories about stuff. I mean, it's gangster
stuff. So what's going on in their lives at the current moment.
And folk music really was a kind of reportage of the times, you know?
Yep. This is today's blues. It's just not my kind of blues.
Yeah. Now, is there anything new you listen to?
No, absolutely nothing. Nothing. You know, there's some new blues bands and stuff, but it's been done, and I'd rather listen to the masters. So, you know, it's just me.
Yeah.
So there's nothing new that interesting comedically or musically. That there's nothing. Just keep patch, keep walking, you know. I'm not interested.
Now, does that make you feel old?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I look at my ticket stubs I've saved. It's November 5th, 1970. Holy shit. You know, yeah, that makes me feel old, very old. But when I interviewed Edgar Winter a while ago for my late great podcast show Riffarendum, which is still on the computer, by the way, if you're interested, and he said something really interesting, that it's every generation's job and duty to artistically make the generation before them uncomfortable. So they've done it with rap. So, you know, I always thought that was a very good quote. So that's what they did. So they're making us uncomfortable. So, yeah.
Well,
of course,
you know,
rap now has been around for two generations, so I don't know one generation from the other, but, yeah.
See, I hate to put anything down that's new.
Hello.
Because I worry that I am making myself dispensable, you know? I mean,
we're all dispensable.
I'd like to be able to really get into rap music, and some of the rap music I've heard I've actually liked, you know?
Yeah.
But some of it, I'd like to know it better so I could distinguish between good and bad rap. Okay.
Well, there's East Coast and there's West Coast. I can't tell the difference. I don't listen to it, so you know, there's all kinds of
my father, who things. Was my father was a musician. He was a violinist.
Yeah.
Taught me that there's no such thing as bad there's no such thing as bad music. In other words, you can't say rap is bad. Okay.
Yeah.
There is only good and bad music.
Yeah.
And within a certain thing like rap, if you want to keep with it, you should know the difference between good rap and bad rap.
Well, that's like we got to know there's good rotten food and bad rotten food. It's all rotten.
Well, no, but in the case of rap, I mean, there are a couple of people who have done, I think, fairly significant stuff.
Okay.
You know, I can't name them. But
I can't either.
I've heard somewhere, I go, you know, it's pretty good. You know, he's doing the reportage, as I said.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of I'm funny about all this. I'm mixed about it. That's the other problem.
Yep.
but I don't want to feel that I don't know it, and yet I really don't know it. And like my wife said, it goes in one ear and out the other. It's there.
Yeah, same with me. Yeah,
you know,
it just doesn't do it for me. So I don't like classical music. I respect it. There's some brilliant stuff out there, but it just doesn't do anything for me.
Okay, So I'm an old guy.
I'm not gonna put rap in the same category as classical, but if I don't like it, I don't like it. I don't like eating tomatoes. I'm not against it if somebody does like tomatoes. So, you know, be knock yourself out, but just keep it off my lawn.
What's the majority of the music on my iPhone? A long time ago, somebody gave me every song ever recorded by Frank Sinatra.
Oh, my God. I'd love to have that.
Yeah, and I put it on my iPhone. And I listened to nothing but Sinatra for the longest time. Now I'm starting to listen to other stuff, too. But Sinatra was my main go-to thing. And I didn't like Sinatra that much. I didn't like him that much when I was younger. When I was younger, I was into I remember my first big mania for a musician was Fats Domino.
Oh, I love Fats Domino.
Yeah. And Fats, by the way, folks, in case you want to dismiss him, had, I think, if I'm not mistaken, either the same amount as or more hits than Elvis Presley.
Wow. How about that? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's a lot of hits.
I mean, he had
a lot of good stuff.
Yeah, he had about 20 number one hits. I mean, he was an amazing career. And that was all out of New Orleans.
Yep. And Dave Bartholomew, that's not an Antoine Domino.
Yep. Dave Bartholomew was a genius behind all that.
Yep.
I love Fats Domino. That was my...
Me too.
And then I started getting a little bit of taste, and I started learning good from bad, and then I got into Chuck Berry, who to this day I think defined rock and roll.
Sure, his songs are amazing. Americana all the way.
You know, he didn't do
Teenage Angst.
What was the first rock and roll record? I have heard people say what it was. I just want to know what you think it was.
Oh, it's debatable. Like you go, God, there's one called Hey Bud Officer from 1953, which counts as rock and roll. There's some old blues. It's so debatable. You know, you can't.
I always hear is the first rock and roll record was Rocket 88 by Ike Turner.
Oh, that's a good one, yeah, but that's rock and roll. But there were records before that kind of rocked out, so, you know.
Well, I mean,
you
could go back before that, and you had, I'm trying to remember who some of the people were, but you had some musicians doing what was the edge of rock and roll. It was more, you know, the edge of R&B, but they hadn't quantified it. But supposedly Ike Turner did, you know.
Yeah.
In fact, Ike Turner was really terrific.
Oh, he's a talent scout back then in Memphis for Sun Records or one of those record labels.
But I mean, he knew talent when he saw it and knew how to develop it. And for all the
boy, could he break a nose, but that's another story.
Well, you know, you hear all those stories that Tina told, and I guess since she wrote the book, I guess that remains the history. But, you know, Tina, you wouldn't be what you became if it weren't for Ike.
That's right.
You know?
Yep.
Just like Gwyneth Paltrow wouldn't have become what she did if it weren't for Harvey Weinstein.
Oh, God.
You know, who bought her an Academy Award.
That's right.
So, you know, it's a give and take. I mean, yeah, Ike Turner, I guess, was terrible. I guess he did beat the shit out of her, and it was terrible and all of that. But nevertheless, nobody would have ever heard of Tina Turner if Ike Turner hadn't created her.
That's true. The good and the bad. Yeah, Hitler the fascist and Hitler the wonderful artist, you know. It depends how you want to judge it.
And I would just once like to hear her say, you know, Ike Turner treated me terribly, but I have to give him credit for making me what I am. I mean, she never says that, you know.
Nope.
And what he did, what he did
that
was terrible.
Ungrateful bitch.
Ungrateful bitch. Yeah, you just hit her to make her shut up.
She could have thanked him through her body cast.
Yeah, I mean, he was terrible to her. I mean, he was terrible. He was a terrible guy that way. But you have to give him credit. he was phenomenal. That whole act, the Iquettes, all of that.
Yeah,
people,
sure.
People forget there was a period. Do you remember there was a period where the Iquettes had hits?
Yeah.
You know? this was a guy with a Midas touch when it came to music, and he gets dismissed completely because of Tina's version of him.
Yeah, of course, bam, bang, ping, boom.
And let's face it, no matter how terrible a person you are, no matter what you've done to somebody else like that, you have to
give
the person credit for what he did.
Yep.
You know, I mean, even Weinstein, you got to give him credit for creating all the Academy Award winning pictures he created.
Yeah.
So, you know,
let's think of all the good people Jeffrey Dahmer didn't eat. So.
Yes. Right. All the McDonald's burgers he had instead.
Yeah, that's right. Could have been somebody.
Not saying these are great guys. What I'm saying is, they're great guys. They're not great guys, but let's not diminish their contributions. That's all.
Exactly. That's right. John Wayne Gacy was a hell of a painter. You leave him alone.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And who was the clown?
You need a clown. You need a clown a painting or a clown in person. You call John Wayne Gacy.
Yeah. Hey, we've run out of time. We've run out of a year, too, by the way.
Well, that was quick. My God, that one didn't run.
This is the last one for the year.
That's right. Oh, man, 2020. Look out. Hugh Downs. He's coming.
So as I did with Bubs yesterday, thank you so very much for having been a part of my life this year.
And thank you, my friend.
And we'll see you again next year, ladies and gentlemen.
Next year, my friend. That's only around the corner.
That's Stephen Pearl. Thanks, Stephen.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Alex. See you in a short while.
5 years and still talking, this is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk like you've never heard it before.
And there we had Stephen Pearl. Always love to have Stephen on. Last appearance of the year. In fact, tomorrow night's our last show of the year because we take the last week. Traditionally, we've taken the last week of the year off. We'll do some, I don't know, replay some old programming and stuff like that. Nothing much. Nothing for you to really listen to. Now I'm trying to get Skype to start here, but it just keeps bouncing up and down. Oh, God. You know, okay, there we go. There we go. Okay. Jeez almighty, you know, every night there's been something a little wrong. I mean, this is okay, though. I'm fine now. Yeah, I'm fine, I think. We'll see. Okay. Here comes Kathleen. Let's see here. There she is. And here comes Phil Meyer. Let me move him. There he is. He's in this place where he was last night, so we just have to fill that place in the middle.
My place of honor.
Yeah. Here comes Charlie Wallace. Let me see here.
The usual suspects.
Yeah. Let me see here. He was there before, too. Oh, boy. Everybody's in the same place they were last night, which shows you know, same old crowd, folks. Same
okay,
old game.
East Coast and West Coast rap. Okay, so East Coast rap, they usually use funk samples in their songs, and their songs are more about gang life and anti-police, and it's, you know, Snoop Dogg, Dre, blah, blah, blah. East Coast rap is usually more about poverty and crime, and they use more jazz samples. They use no funk samples. And they have DJs and MCs. That's where all that started out. And it's like, it would probably be like Biggie and I know the freaking whitest shiksa telling you about.
Well, that would be Biggie and Tupac.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah. So, where did you learn all this?
Well, I worked in Oakland for 24 years, and I worked in Richmond for 3 out of my 27 years at UPS.
Okay, and so now she told us, I guess that was off of the interview I did with Pearl, and
yeah,
we were talking about rap, and neither, I mean, I know a little bit about rap. I mean, I know about Biggie and Tupac and, you know, things like that, but I don't really get into it 100%, so.
Well, if you listen to, like, Eminem, he does a lot of his phrasing is like Sinatra's when he raps.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Well, I will have to listen to some Eminem sometime. Or eat some.
I'd rather
eat some
listen to,
as well. What?
I'd rather listen to country music with the worst twang in the world than rap music.
Well, I never liked the term rap music. Is it music?
Well, the first, they think who did it is. The first rap? Was it, who was it? It was
Rap's
Delight.
No, I'll tell you. I'll tell you.
70 something.
Oh, I go back. I can go back, take you back further than that. I was playing in New York and used to have on my show a group of guys called The Last Poets. And it's the first time I remember ever hearing that kind of thing. And what it did is it came out of prisons because they were called toasts. And so if you ever get a chance, go listen to The Last Poets. They were amazing. But I had them on my show, what, in, 76, maybe earlier than that, you know? So, yeah, that's my, I'm sticking to that story.
I like the Mighty Boosh when they would crimp.
Will you shut the fuck up?
I used to primp, but I don't have enough hair left.
What is with this? What oh, boy. Yeah, well, anyway.
Actually, I listen to music from all over the world. That's why I'm so happy that Tower Records closed.
Wait a minute.
Place to go.
Why? Why are you happy?
Well, because remember, I'd be leaving your place and you'd say, are you going to Tower Records? Yep, and you'd be right behind me.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you could listen to the music and I would go, I'd be all over the place.
Well, that's also where I bought my laser discs.
Yep.
You know. And, but what I didn't like about Tower Records was the guys behind the counter. I tried to one time explain to them, that they weren't in the music business. They were just selling it.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, what happened was there was this horrible actress by the name of Pia Zadora.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Which we all said that if she ever married Ronnie Lott, her name would be Pia Lott.
Yep.
And Pia Zadora, but she put out an album singing, and she was really good. She was really, really good. So I went into Tower Records, and I said, yeah, Pia Zadora's album? And the guy behind the counter goes, what do you want that for? And I'm going, hey, just sell me the fucking music.
Yeah.
Don't comment on it. You're not a reviewer, you know.
You know, my brother Mike worked at Tower Records years ago. So one day I called him up, you know, can I please speak with Michael Halstead? And they put me on hold. And all of a sudden there's Jimmy Stewart doing an advertisement for Tower Records. And I'm going, holy shit, how did they get Jimmy Stewart? So my brother comes on the phone and we're chatting about stuff. And then before we hang up, I go, oh my God, Mike, how'd you guys get Jimmy Stewart to do that ad for Tower Records? He goes, Kath, that's me. I go, he sounded just
like Jimmy
him.
Stewart.
He goes, you know, they want me to do some stuff. So I do some stuff for them.
Wow. Wow. So anyway, I guess this is going to be it, huh?
Tonight?
Looks like it. Yeah, it looks like it.
You know. Also, I can say something that'll get some people upset, and then they'll call in.
Well, yeah, but wait a while. Wait a while. We'll hold that as our ace in the hole if nobody calls, okay? And then that doesn't make them call. It just makes them turn off their computers, you know.
Not necessarily.
Yeah. I've seen a couple of good movies lately. I saw the best movie of the year. Literally, maybe the best movie of the decade.
What's that?
It's a film called 1917. And
a little dated, don't you think?
Yeah, it's a little dated. Yeah. And it is the most phenomenal motion picture I've seen in years. I mean, it's just amazing. And it's coming out on Christmas Day, and then opening up wide, as they like to say in the whorehouses all over, opening wide on the 10th of January. And I got to see it because a friend of mine belongs to the Directors Guild, and he had a copy, and we brought it home and watched it. And Marjorie found it so upsetting, so tense.
Yeah.
She said her stomach was starting to hurt. Because
what was it about?
That's what the commercials do to me.
You've seen the commercials for it.
Yeah.
Yeah. What it is, how do I explain this? It's about World War One. And the trenches in World War One. And these two soldiers are ordered to take a message across no man's land to this other regiment to tell them not to attack because it's a trap. All right? That's the plot. That's it, plain and simple. It's all done in one tracking shot.
Holy shit.
All 2 hours is one complete tracking shot. It really isn't. They use some tricks to do it, and it's amazing because they say, "Hey, it's a long tracking shot," but then 2 hours go by and 2 days have happened already. You know, but the camera never keeps moving, never stops moving, and so you are now carried along with them into the middle of this thing, and so it just becomes really tense.
Because your stomach get knotted up.
Yeah. Oh, it is absolutely amazing, and it's directed by the guy who did the Bond pictures and did American Beauty, and I'm trying to remember his name now. What is it? I can't remember. No, well, I'll remember a little bit later. Great film, just a great film. And then I started. I managed to get my access to all the screeners for the SAG Awards, and we watched Bombshell, the movie about Fox News and about Megyn Kelly and Gretchen Carlson.
Oh, yeah.
And it's really good. It's really good. I expected it to suck. I expect it to be mediocre. It was really quite good.
It's in theaters now.
No, it's in theaters tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Mm-hmm. What other screeners did they give you?
Oh, I think I got about 17 of them. Joker.
Yeah.
You know, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I can't remember all the ones I got, but that are available. They do them online now. It used to be they would send you the discs, right?
Yeah.
But they don't really do that anymore. They do it so that you put this app on your Apple TV, and then you can watch the thing.
Can you play them over GabNet in a continuous loop of 17 movies judge?
Not really. Not really. And even if I could, I would be in trouble, you know.
Yeah.
Some of the movies, though, it bothers me. They've got, like, SAG and then my ID number imprinted in the middle of the picture. Kind of softly, but it's there.
Like a watermark.
Yeah, so the watermark so that nobody can steal it. Some films don't have that, though. So, but it really...
If you don't see it, it doesn't mean they don't have it. Some of them are digitally identifiable to you.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So this is about the only way they can really do it, though. The other ways, they're just bullshitting that they're doing it. You know? But anyway, so I got all these movies to watch, and you know, I'm looking forward to Joker, which I hear is a great film. Mm. And I'm trying to remember all the other films that Jojo something, I can't remember. But the Parasite, which is a lot of people say that is one of the best films of the year, and really, really good stuff. But I mean, 1917. You should go to a theater to watch it. You know, it's just an amazing motion picture. So, anyway, that's it. That's it for me, folks. Thank you. Good night. Thanks for joining me. What? I got another hour and 15 minutes. So tomorrow I go to my doctor. No, don't give me that look. It's not like... Geez.
I know, but it's like, well, what are you going for? Is that just all the preliminary?
Yeah, what happens whenever they put you out, you have to get an okay from your doctor. So I have to go have him draw some blood and do some things, and then send the whole thing over to my doctor and say, it's okay if you gas him, you know.
He won't die, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So they can then put me out for 10 minutes, you know. There are two occasions they're going to put me out in this whole process. One takes an hour, and one takes, like, literally 10 minutes.
Wow.
They put what's called a spacer in me, which goes between my rectum and my prostate so that the rectum doesn't get affected by the radiation. Otherwise, you can get some, like, permanent damage and stuff that you get. So they do that. And and I said, am I going to feel that afterwards? And he says, no, it's just there. I think it's a gel they put between.
Yeah, you were saying that yesterday. Yeah.
Mm. So when you take a crap after the radiation, will the radiation kill the smell?
No, it will probably make the toilet explode.
Or glow.
Everything will be glowing.
Be this mushroom cloud coming up out of the toilet. Yeah. Well, I can't, I can't get near pregnant women for about, I think, 2 weeks, something like that. It's not a long time, although the radiation exists for about 2 months.
Yeah.
This is really I'm kind of looking forward to it because one of the things I'm doing is this cyber knife, and it's this giant machine that just like does all this kind of stuff around you and to the side of you, and it's all pre-programmed because they've figured out where they want the stuff to go and blah. And I'm looking forward to that. It's all sci-fi. You know,
yeah. One of your listeners, who's a friend, becoming a friend of mine, wrote me after I talked about the machine that they use for my operations called a Da Vinci, and he says that the company that sells and developed the Da Vinci is down the street from his company, and so I looked up the stock. It's trading at $523 a share for this, the company that sells or makes this machine.
Yeah, that sounds good. The Da Vinci, yeah? Yeah.
Da Vinci, yeah.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
Sounds like my echocardiogram. They would have me drink this radioactive solution, and then I'd lay down on this machine, and it's going all around me, and it's projecting.
It's a CT scan, isn't it?
Well, it's a 3D image of my heart.
No, that's not an... I don't think that's
an MRI?
I don't know that that's an echocardiogram, because I've had an echocardiogram, and it's not that way exactly.
They didn't make me drink anything when I did those things for the heart.
No,
they injected me with a dye in my arm.
That's a CT scan is what you're talking about. It's not, you know...
But the machine was like magnets, and it went around...
That's a CT scan. A CT scan. And what they do, they have like a mini CT scan or something they use with this cyber knife, so they can just see exactly where they're hitting the prostate with the radiation and so on. And the reason I'm getting two different kinds of radiation is to make sure they get everything. You know.
Yeah, I kept falling asleep in that machine, and they had to redo it. redo the photo.
Really? You know what they do for this thing? For the cyber knife. I mean, this is all sci-fi. I love this.
Are you closed in or
you go in, and the first time you go in, it's not, they don't do the radiation or anything. It's called the rehearsal. And you go in there, and you lie down on this stuff. And then they, out of that stuff, they make a cast. of a literally a bed you will lie in so you don't move.
So when you go to this rehearsal, do you go, ta-da?
Yeah, right.
I'm alive.
Right. But no, but I thought that that was really kind of cool, you know, that we're going to have a rehearsal beforehand. I'm used to that, you know. And then so then they see where they're going to do it and how they're going to do it and everything. And then you go in, and he told me it takes from the time you walk in to the time you leave 45 minutes. And there are five sessions over a period of a week and a half, and that's through. And then about a month later, he sticks something up my ass and goes puts in all those what do you call it?
Now, do you get to keep the bed afterwards? Can you imagine the support you're going to get on this bed?
Yeah.
You know?
No, I don't think so. They probably
wonder what they do with it.
I'd probably throw it out, you know. Yeah. The thing that's interesting about all of this, the only thing that's going to be of a bother to me are the side effects. You know, the actual process is just nothing and nothing.
You mean nausea and that stuff? Or?
I don't think nausea is part of this. No, no, it's not. What is part of it is having to feel like you have to pee. Hello, Jeff. Feel like you have to pee all the time, and you know, and that might be helped by the Cialis, you know.
Well, ask him about that stuff that I'm taking. I think it's Trespian.
Believe me, this doctor will give me anything that I need to make and ease this up, and I'm sure he knows all about it, Phil.
It's supposed to deal with the having to pee all the time.
Well, yeah, but this is it's going to be for a different reason than you, okay. This is going to be because they're radiating the prostate, which is then pushing against stuff and so on. So I don't know. He'll probably give me something to ease it if I feel that it's any kind of a real problem. The other side effects, there really aren't that many other side effects, you know, because this is very targeted radiation as opposed to the kind of like, you know, like... Vernon Nunn told me he did like the 40-day course, and that kind of splatters the radiation all over. This targets it specifically to the prostate and doesn't go and hit your rectum, doesn't go and hit your other vital organs. So, you know.
Well,
so hopefully, you know, hopefully I'll tolerate it okay, and, you know, but that's going to be the worst part about it. There's no pain involved. Yeah.
Will you be able to sit after this?
Oh, yeah, sure. of course, any place I sit, there'll be a little glow after I leave, you know. But
and, you know, the other thing is, will you be able to play the piano?
No, but then I couldn't play it before. So, you know.
All right.
Yeah. But, no, I think it's really, really quite fun and amazing, you know. And I'm looking forward to it.
As Stephen Pearl would say, hey, it's going to be a laugh a minute.
Yeah. I mean, the part I worry about are the side effects. It's all, you know, and who knows? My side effects may be just minimal. You know, he said some people it's very minimal. Other people it's, you know, they have a low tolerance and so on. But, you know, it's only going to be the whole process. If they get to the second part fast enough, the whole process is only going to take about a month, you know. So, I mean, that's sure better than having to go for, you know, 5 days a week for 8 weeks to go get radiated, you know. And he says they don't even really do that anymore. He said that's considered too passe. And there are things he won't do because I'm older, you know.
Did he mention ripping it out?
He said that's not even a question. You know, he says, to begin with, we would never remove your prostate because of your age. Yeah. That's for starters. And secondly, there are so many other things they can do to handle it. You know, if all this fails and it comes back, okay, the PSA goes rising up again or whatever... Then you get
the radiation.
Then I got the hormones, and the hormones always work. They will take a was a doctor told me he knew somebody with a PSA of about a 30 or something like that, and he gave him the hormones, and within a month or so, it was down to a 1.
Wow.
You know, because what it does, I mean, that's not pleasant, but what it does is it starves the cancer from not having any testosterone. Okay. I have a lot of testosterone. That's why this.
Well, at least you wouldn't have to shave anymore.
And Kathleen knows I have a lot of testosterone. She sampled it. Okay. It's a new Italian ice, testosterone. it really is a. The cancer, if it's robbed of testosterone, actually prostate cancer dies. It can't survive. So as long as you're taking robbing your testosterone from this whole system. But what happens is he said to me, we don't want to do that to you if we don't have to. He said, because, you know, at your age, you need all the testosterone you can get, you know. Oh, yeah, fatigue may be another side effect. So I may do shows some night or not do shows some night as I go through this period and see how, you know, how it's affecting me that way. But then again, I'm always fatigued anyway, so I don't know how I'm going to tell the difference. But anyway, what the hell? I'm happy that I know what we're going to do. And that it's not going to be that horrible. So, what the hell? You know, I just want to get it over and done with so I can get on with my life. Yeah. And then I'm taking a big vacation. I don't know where, but I'm taking a vacation.
Nice.
I haven't taken one since about 9 years. So, time to do that. Time to enjoy life a little bit.
Yeah.
You know?
Good idea.
So where should I go? Don't tell me, Phil. You're gonna say
St. Petersburg.
Yeah, St. Petersburg. Good. I thought
Russia.
I told Marjorie. I said we're going on vacation, and she said where? And I said Long Island. So anyway, or as we here in New York say it, Long Island. It's one word. Long Island.
One word.
Yeah. Yeah.
Long Island.
Yeah. Tony, where would you suggest I go? Oh, you don't go on vacations. I don't think you've ever left your fucking house. What?
You liked Italy, didn't you? You always raved about Italy.
I liked Italy.
I loved Italy.
But I didn't see much of Italy because I had a wife who couldn't walk. Remember? She was on crutches.
Oh, that's right. What about Rome? Go back.
Rome.
I didn't go to Rome.
Okay. But now you could because she's feeling better. That's right. She got hurt.
Remember the video?
Yeah, we got a whole video of that trip, and it gets worse.
Would you want to leave the country? That's the whole thing.
Is that where you pushed her down the steps?
Yeah. No, as the vacation goes on, she in the beginning she's walking. By the end of it, she's being lifted into a plane by an elevator thing. That you know. Yeah, I mean it just got worse and worse and worse. But the thing was, if you ever are traveling in Europe and you really want to get a great treatment, what you do is simply, and it's very important that you do this, tell them that you go with crutches and everything, and they will do everything to accommodate you because they don't want to get sued, okay? And what's great about that they don't want to get sued is that on top of that, if you have to go through customs, you just slide right through. You know, she had a wheelchair and I was pushing the wheelchair. Forget it. Everybody stand back. Gimp coming through, you know. Yeah. I mean, and
it ended the line.
We had to go from we had a stop where we had to go from one, not airport, but, you know.
Terminal
to another. Yes, thank you. one terminal to another, and they got us a car. They got a car to take us there that was specially made for a wheelchair, you know. So whenever, if you really want to travel to Europe and have a good time, just do it in a wheelchair.
You know, the curbs aren't set up for wheelchairs. The there isn't a lot of handicap access like we do have here.
How do you? Really? What do you mean? Are you nuts?
Yeah, what do you think?
Are you nuts? What you have your whole attitude about Europe and places like that is like they're living in the dark ages when they've had all this.
I've been to Europe many times.
They had all this shit before we did.
Well, you know, I don't think so, but
I know they, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean,
they're not going to change the curbs of a 1,000-year-old street because somebody's in a wheelchair.
Sure, they will. All they got to do is put a little dent in it so that you can wheel a wheelchair on it. They
don't
it.
Do that. Sure.
They've done it with
you
all.
Go over to cobblestone street.
They've done it with all. Phil, where are you going in Europe?
I go to places that are old, you know, whether it be Milan or Florence or Naples.
You stay in the cheap part of town? Is that what this is all about?
Oh, yeah.
Ye old Europe.
Yeah. Ye old Europe.
You go to places like London and Oxford and Stratford-on-Avon and all of these places. They're 1,000 years old. They don't accommodate nothing.
We might be thinking Sicily or something. Is it Sicily really old?
I've never been to Sicily.
I think that's like old. I think Rome, where he's going, if he went, that's got to be all modern, no?
I think Rome is just polluted.
No.
What is with you? And you have absolutely this. What were you going to say, Kevin?
I said, that's what I've heard too. People have told me you better be prepared to go over there if you're going to be doing a lot of walking, because I have to be prepared for stuff like that.
Yeah. Oh,
wow. And they said, you know, they don't have the handicap spots or anything like that over there. You park and you got to walk your ass.
Well, we feel that makes you more self-sufficient.
Well, yeah, that's true.
What do you think, you're Patrick?
You know, like,
I'd say fuck it.
No, like I honestly believe that people who have disabilities should have to do things like, why should they be able to park in a handicapped parking spot right in front of the supermarket? I think they should have to park all the way back and then have to use their energy to get them to the supermarket. I think by coddling them, thank God Patrick can't call tonight or tomorrow night. But
and he ripped his cornea out.
Yeah. Oh, that's a simple operation.
He could sit there and listen and cuss out, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Say,
yeah.
Fuck you.
Yeah. But
he could save it up till next year.
You know, I just think that we're doing a great disservice to these people by coddling them. You give them a reason to try and walk or at least crawl.
Now.
Roll over the thing.
Yeah. I have my placard and I use it when I need it, and that's the only time I use it.
Oh, really? You have one of those placards?
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
You know, I was
You're talking to one of them.
I was in in Seoul, Korea, and the one thing I noticed there is that everybody was working. There was no graffiti. And there were no handicapped people anywhere, and there were no provisions for handicapped people anywhere.
Because they put them away in some
attic, huh?
In a closet somewhere.
But you know, they get the fire hoses out and
I gotta tell you, the United States was a little late on all this stuff, though. A lot of countries were doing it before us. We're always a little slow on the uptake on this kind of stuff. You know, and your whole idea is that any place else in the world is like living in prehistoric times, you know.
Absolutely.
And you're out of your fucking mind. We're living in prehistoric times here because we got a president that's a fucking caveman.
Yeah.
You know, talking about Trump, you know what he said today? He said we got the lowest black unemployment rate since the abolition and the Emancipation Proclamation.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
He says all kinds of shit.
He didn't say something like since the black was invented or something
since
like
black
that.
Black was invented, yeah.
Jesus Christ, that guy's so, very creative. That guy's so off.
Guy.
Yeah. He said before charcoal, you know?
Yeah. Before minstrel shows.
What the hell did he say about Dingle yesterday?
I don't remember what he said, but I think that he didn't insult her husband first or vice versa.
He insulted her husband by handing back the flag and saying, well, as long as he's looking down or maybe looking up.
Is that what he said?
Yeah. Yep, he said looking up. In other words, saying from hell.
What a fucking motherfucking
Hey, what is why nobody sucker. Black will vote for him?
I don't know. You got that Kanye West.
How do you defend that kind of behavior, Phil?
What?
What he did with Dingle.
What he did? I think he got called out on it by...
just about everybody.
Graham?
Lindsey Graham called him out on it.
Yeah, yeah.
Who the fuck is he nowadays?
Yeah, well, maybe he was stressed.
You know, when Lindsey Graham takes you to the woodshed, you know you're being taken to the woodshed because there isn't a bigger asshole than that. You
about know? As soft as Jello.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he says some things that you know you wish he wouldn't, but he thinks he's a comedian. Hey, he should call into Gabnet.
Yeah. Right.
Maybe you have him on Fridays.
Well, having you here is the next best thing.
That's true.
Yeah, yeah. I heard a little bit about that Dingle thing because I was watching TV out of the side of my head, and I saw Mrs. Dingle talking with somebody about what supposedly something Trump had said, but I didn't know what it was, so thank you for informing me that, once again, this man is capable of bad taste.
During a rally, and even his people at the rally kind of went, let's see, are we supposed to laugh now? Okay, laugh. Ha, 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 ha.
Wow. That's terrible.
You know, hey. It was like, you know.
Some moron on the chat wrote, Phil's attempting to be a comedian. I have an answer for them. You get what you pay for.
Yeah. Wow, what an interesting topic. Alex's rectum. Rectum. Be back for Jack's
rectum. I guess
we'll
come back for Jack's rectum.
Oh, I see. At least he's got something to talk about. Yeah. Old Rin Tin Tin movies. Okay, so, you know.
Well, hey, Jack may talk about his rectum. And, you know.
Did I miss rectum talk? Damn it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm going to do with Zim here? Let's see. I can do something with his thing. Let's see here. I'll remove what he said. Okay, there it goes. It's gone. You see?
Message deleted.
Yes.
It's gone. Wow.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. So.
You showed power. Him.
Fuck you, Zim. Fuck you, Zim. Yeah. And the fuck you, Zim, and your lousy hamburgers.
Yeah.
Remember,
you know,
Zim's?
I never used to eat at Zim's.
I love Zim's.
There was one at what, 19th and 19th and Lincoln?
Something like that.
Yeah, somewhere around there, yeah.
Yeah, I love Zim's. I used to go out of my way to go to Zim's and get a Zim burger.
Good coffee, too.
Are they there anymore? Nah.
No, I don't think so. Yeah. Well, you know, I don't know. I haven't been over there in 25, 30 years.
Really?
19th and Lincoln, no, they're not there no more.
No. They probably sold the building.
Yeah, yeah. Kathleen, you like purple, don't you? Because you wear purple a lot on this show.
I guess because a lot of my workout stuff is purple.
Is purple? Purple? let me ask you a question. Anybody watch this debate tonight?
Oh, I did.
Well, no, I didn't.
Did you supposedly Buttigieg and Elizabeth Warren got into it?
And Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders were ready to kill each other. It was good.
That's awesome.
Oh, all really? Right. Really, it's wonderful.
Warren slams Pete over Wine Cave's video? What the fuck is that?
What?
I'm looking at a headline on Drudge. Warren slams Pete over Wine Cave's video.
I didn't get that.
They had a fundraiser.
She was ready to cry.
Wait a minute. What were you saying, Charlie?
Getting emotional over the house.
Buttigieg had a fundraiser with rich people in the Wine Cave.
Well, who else gives money?
Yeah, I mean, you got to go.
You're
where
gonna
you
get a what kind of fundraiser you're gonna have with poor people? You're gonna end up giving them all the food, and they're not gonna donate anything. Oh, give me that hors d'oeuvre. Well, I'll send you a check. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, Liz, go out and get your money from poor people. See what that gets you. You know, of course, you know.
I don't know. Bernie's raised more money than Buttigieg.
Probably has. He's always had a certain kind of mania behind him. I mean, Buttigieg is new to this, and I think he's been doing quite well, all things considered. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's taking the big donor money.
But you know something? Yes, Jeff.
I think Bernie takes a lot of money from small pieces.
And not
the most richest people. And I think one of the reasons is a lot of the youngsters really like him. And, you know, my young son, he's 27 or 28, he really loves Bernie.
You would think the unions would be donating to Bernie.
Wouldn't you think that you think the reason that Bernie is so popular with young people is he kind of has that grandpa thing going for him?
Nah, he's a socialist, and they want stuff for free.
Well, yeah, he does, yeah. But him and Joe Biden got really excited in this.
Really?
Yeah, he's getting pretty worked up.
Wait a minute. Hold on a second.
For free. That's why they donate.
Hey, did
first
Joe Biden
of all,
wake
first
up?
Of all, first he of did. All, yeah, I'm saying that I can't imagine Joe Biden getting agitated about anything.
He got agitated. Did you see it, Kevin?
What did he do? Run his hands through somebody's hair?
Well, wait a minute. Let Tony tell us what he saw.
What did he say?
Well, whatchamacallit, Bernie Sanders was talking about health care. Mm-hmm. And Biden, he was kind of trying to say, like, Biden's thing wasn't doable like the way he wanted it. And he didn't like the way he was coming across. And when Bernie was talking after Biden talked, he just jumped up and he just goes, it's my turn to rebuttal. Like she says, you'll have a chance. Like he just got really agitated. Like it didn't look presidential to me. It looked like he was mad.
Well, I'll tell you, I really.
He challenged a guy to a push-up contest. He gets mad fast.
Yeah. I'd like to see him do that push-up contest or hit somebody.
He'd probably teach you more than me.
I'd like to see how many bones he breaks, you know.
Biden's kind of a why I oughta person.
Yeah.
I'm
really quite worried, guys, that the Trump may win the next election because I don't think the Democrats have anybody.
You can stop worrying, Alex. He's going to win.
Oh, okay.
You heard he's got a name for Buttigieg now.
Now, what's that?
Yeah, he's calling him Alfred E. Newman now.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that was a long time ago, yeah.
Wait a minute. I'm trying to
get... He's bringing it out more now.
I can't get Patrick on here. There we go. I think we...
You see that?
Now you can start talking shit about him.
Okay, wait a minute. Hold on a second. I got to go to my... other thing here, and
hey, Patrick's got an eye on us.
But hold on a second. Darth Pat, okay, and
how
then
you feeling,
we
buddy?
Go. Wait a minute, there it's we go, okay. And
he's gonna give us the evil eye.
Wait a minute, you don't have any cup on your eyes?
No.
Why?
You don't need one.
But see, where's the cup down there? Oh. You know, just like.
Well,
the
wait a minute. When did you have the eye thing done?
You want to see the other cup? There's no cup. No patch. Uh-huh. I just wear a patch when I go to bed, and it's a clear plastic.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Had it yesterday or today?
Wait a minute. Can I ask him the question?
I was repeating it because he didn't hear it.
But you had to put the cup on your eye when you went to sleep, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So that's
so you don't accidentally poke yourself in your sleep.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I'm calling tonight is I got to be up at 4 o'clock anyway. So I took a nap when I got home. So I'm up now and I'm just going to stay up until the cripple van comes to pick me up. I have a follow-up visit right away in the morning at about 7.
Yeah.
So the band will be here a little bit before 6, so yeah. I'd have to be up at 4, so I might as well just stay up. So I figured I'd call you and Jack, and then I'll watch some fucking television.
What was I right? It was very simple, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was longer to get me prepped. Mm-hmm. And in fact, what was great is I didn't even have to get undressed other than take my shirt off. They let me keep my jeans on and my shoes.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't have to take my shirt off.
Well, I had to take my shirt off. They had to put their sticky things with the wires and that shit. So whatever they were doing. But the great thing is that after the surgery, because I was awake through the whole thing, and he was talking to me, and I was talking to him. So we finished, and I said, so now am I going to be able to walk again? And the doctor said, oh, that's what we were supposed to do today?
So you should have told him you put the marker in the wrong spot.
Yeah, yeah.
It's still on my forehead.
Yeah. I saw the picture earlier.
Yeah.
I was rubbing alcohol, and it just... I'll probably just have to wear off.
They want
to
make
sure. If you were a Hindu, you'd come with your own marker. They put it right there.
That's not nice, Phil.
That's nice.
Okay, if you were Catholic and they give you that.
Okay, that okay.
A little bit of ash, boom.
When I first came, you know, I never saw Ash Wednesday in its brutal form until I came back to New York. And then it was Ash Wednesday, and I'm at Sirius, and people are walking in with these smudges on their heads. And you just want to do this.
I know. It's so stupid.
You know, they just went like this, and then they said, "I voted." You know,
I voted.
Try going to a Catholic school.
Yeah, but the cataract thing. Is it so simple now? It's ridiculous. I mean, it's just I have a doctor who it's like cataracts or us, and you go there, and there are like 20 people, and they're all in these little chairs waiting, and it's next, and then you go in 15 minutes, beep, 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 next guy, meep, 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 next guy, meep, meep, meep. Amazing, just amazing.
I got cataracts, but they're not ripe. This ripe shit.
Yeah,
I don't
talk
understand.
About ripe.
I can't see at night. Give me the goddamn thing. I don't want to wear glasses anymore.
Yeah.
See, your insurance company won't pay for it till they're
Kaiser.
Ripe.
Kaiser.
Like Kaiser, you're not getting
Medicare fraud. At Kaiser, they robbed you of your prostate. So just remember, that's Kaiser for you.
Well, they could have.
Marjorie
that
said to me, "Why does he have Kaiser? He can afford any hospital plan he can get." And I told him, "I don't know. Something that had to do with you know,
very easy. It is the easiest thing. You go there, they got everything is there. You know, you need a heart operation, boom, they got it. You need a prostate operation, bit a bam, you're done. You know, your toenails need clipping, boom, they got
you
it.
Need a funeral, that's they got that there too.
No, I go to Costco for that.
Now that we got a mock.
Costco's got caskets.
They have caskets. But
go to the wrong window, you're screwed.
The thing is, if you're Jewish, it doesn't work to get a Costco casket because it takes them like 3 days to deliver it, and Jews have to be buried within 2. So
If you do the right thing, you buy it ahead of time, leave it in the living room.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can store stuff in it, you know, kind of like a hope.
I'm only buying my casket from Costco if they can guarantee me that the label on it will say Kirkland.
Well, if you get it from Amazon, you'll have it the next day.
FedEx it.
Amazon delivers the next day and free.
In fact, they can probably get it to you before you. They probably can get it to you just before you die. So that's
you have to buy two of them at a time. They're wrapped together.
Yeah, I know. Yep. Yeah.
We used to joke at UPS about a commercial. If you die on a Wednesday and you want that body next the next day, ship it, next day air. And I thought, oh my God, if we ever start shipping dead bodies, I am out.
By the way, you have, I was talking about this to Marjorie. You have, you still have UPS stock, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because you work for UPS. And the, the people, by the way, at UPS, really, you kind of own the company, right?
When
you
listen, remember in 97, Alex, when went on strike?
Yeah.
Well, what happened is after the strike, UPS went public. The sad thing is during the strike, a lot of the drivers and employees sold their stock out of anger.
Yeah.
And what a mistake that was, because when we went public, the stock doubled and split.
Yeah.
So, no, that's, you know, we're not employee-owned, but that in itself has been a real, like, you know, UPS's stock is probably at 120-something, but when I got it, it was only like 40-something.
Yeah, what I'm saying is, what I was saying to her is, you probably are doing okay with that stock, because considering the influx of Amazon and all of that, it has become a far bigger business, because everything that people get now, they don't go shopping anymore. They just sit there waiting for Amazon to deliver. Let her finish, Phil.
So today at Costco, so I'm in the what's called the wet depot, also known as the chill freeze. So we got done early today and right up the road, because in Tracy, there's four warehouses. There's the store, then there's the dry depot, the wet depot where I work, and then there's e-commerce.
You know, wet depot.
So we got done early, and so I said, well, I'll go to e-com to work another 4 hours. So I'm working like 10 hours a day. And all it is all the online stuff, and it's all going into these UPS trailers.
Yeah. Well, you know, a wet spot? What's the name of that?
It's the wet depot. So we get all the meat, chicken, fish, all the produce, all the frozen stuff. So I work in it's like 35 degrees.
How much are those caskets?
$11.99, Amazon Prime, next day delivery.
Yeah, but they got one there for $67. It's corky.
Yeah, that's a Halloween coffin box, pack of two. Uses a decor or a pet coffin. The big coffin. Oh, they got a white one.
They also have urns. They also have urns there.
I looked up coffin. Here's one for $9.99. What a deal. Free shipping.
oh, my God. They do have it. Yeah. I should get
you
one.
You can get the Titan.
Tony Titan is
$1,074.
Imagine if you weren't home for the day and they just left it on the doorstep.
A biodegradable
bandit tries to steal it.
A biodegradable pine casket, $500. Only one left. Order soon.
That's kind of.
They died 20 years ago. His coffin was like $6,000.
Yeah, Richard Johnson's calling. You there, Richard?
That's morbid.
No, I guess he's not here.
I mean, they can sell everything, but isn't that kind of like, maybe we should sell coffins? Yeah, I mean, come on.
Oh, here's one. And overnight caskets. And Kathleen would like this one. It's Briar Rose Lilac, purple with a pink interior.
Gross.
$12.99. Is that a CD player?
Cremated.
No, it's a casket.
CD player. Wait a minute. Hold on a second. Where is it? Funeral Costco. Here we go. Wait a minute. Here comes Richard again. Richard, are you there? Are you there, Richard? Well, if you're not going to be there, don't call anymore, okay? Thank you.
Having problems.
Okay. Well, yeah, it doesn't matter. let me see here. Where have I
said by the guy that wants more callers?
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, here, folks, you can see we have the. There we go. There you go. There are the caskets. This is for the audience more than anybody else. And look, you got one $9.99. They're all $9.99. There's $12.99, $8.99.
What here, a deal.
Here's like an urn.
Yeah.
That's why you learn.
Oh, yeah. Earn while you learn.
Earn while you learn.
And they have all the, look, a hummingbird adult cremation urn.
Oh, $99.99 for the blue one.
Yeah.
What?
Hey, folks, the fact of the matter is that the, what do you call it? The urns are like $89. That's yeah. cheap, right?
Yeah, but what's the cremation cost?
Well, you know, in India, next to nothing, you know.
That's what you're left with.
Yeah, so that's they do sell them. And here comes, forget it. I don't want Richard Johansson. Forget
it. What's the delivery on these things?
Huh?
What's the delivery? Richard either calls from Norway or Vietnam.
Patrick. Let me do the transition here. Yes, Patrick.
If I would earn, can't he just use a coffee can or some shit? I mean,
yeah, totally.
I got a relative. She passed away, I don't know, like 2 years ago. And she was a big, she'd go to Goodwill and she would buy pottery because she was like an art collector, and she wouldn't buy just garbage. It was shit that she liked it. And she liked like flowered shit. And so she got what she, in her will, she said, put me in this particular
pottery shit base.
Yeah, and that was it. Perfect. And it cost her probably like $3.99 at Goodwill. And, you know, she's sitting on her son's mantle or whatever. So, I don't know. I want to get cremated and then just flush me down the fucking toilet.
So, you know, my friend's mother-in-law died. They cremated her. They put you in a cardboard box. It was a pretty cardboard box, but it was a cardboard box. Uh-huh. And in those years, I had a boat, and we went out into the bay, and they dumped it off the back of my boat, into the bay.
Yeah. I want the whole Big Lebowski thing.
By the way,
I don't think it's legal to do that, but, you know,
who's going
to
see that?
Bree has a very unusual Skype tonight. He's square. He's not widescreen.
Oh, really? No, he's widescreen on mine.
No, he's not.
Yeah.
Not on mine. No, on yours, you can't tell. But look
is
at
there some
the
button screen. I should push to
on my Skype?
I don't know.
Are you on your Russian phone?
No, I am on my Asus ZenBook Pro, which is like the most advanced laptop out there. Yeah. It even has a double screen down below at the trackpad.
I'm going to try Johansson one more time here, and let's see if he...
I got it on sale at Best Buy. It was one of those, somebody bought it, didn't quite like it, took it back, and then I got a big discount on it.
Nice. Mm-hmm.
They got Best Buy at Kuala Lumpur?
No, this was when I was back in the States.
Oh.
Yeah. anyway, I don't have... he just never... He,
Alex, how do you get that thing
with
in the
Richard,
back
you'll
you,
get a full
your
house.
Background is muffled.
What did you say?
No, he blurred it.
With Richard,
yeah, how do you blur that?
It's a Skype thing. With Richard, you get a full house.
No, that would only be 9. We need 10.
No, you got 3, 4.
It's been so long since we've had a full house.
Richard gives you 10.
It's been so long since we've had a full house. Yeah.
It'd be 10, including you, Alex.
Yeah, I guess. But he keeps trying to get in, and then he doesn't get in, and that's kind of annoying.
Yeah.
Kind of annoying. Let me see here. What was it I was going to do? I forgot now. You know. I know what it was. What were you saying about the blurriness?
I got it.
Found
it
out.
Yeah, he blurred his background. He figured it out.
Who did it?
Bree.
Oh, Bree? Oh, okay. All right. Oh, yeah. Yeah, see? That. And I can do it for you guys. You can. I've done it, actually. It's the way it is tonight. Yeah. Oh, that's doesn't seem so personal. That's better. I like that. Don't you like that better?
Yeah, I don't like the blur.
Yeah. You know why they do the blur?
So I'll think that my eyesight is going?
No, because
my sugar's out of control.
No, because it is a thing about people having messy houses and things like that.
Oh my!
And they wanna like, you know, blur themselves. You can do that, right, Kevin? You can blur yourself as
yeah.
well. Yeah.
Or if there's personal shit in your background, they don't want you to. You don't want to show it. That kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a cool thing.
Yeah. You're frozen again, Kevin. Just reboot your camera there for a second.
No, he's not.
No, he's not.
Huh?
He's not frozen for me.
No. Nope.
Really? But he's frozen.
Frozen on your feed.
Yeah.
In the,
yeah. There we go. He's better now.
YouTube.
Yeah. He's.
Yeah. He's prepared documents.
There we go. There we go. There we go.
See him moving.
So you know, we're getting towards this. Is tomorrow night's the last night of the year for our shows.
I know.
We don't have.
When are you back, Alex?
We're back January 2nd.
Oh, you're going to do tomorrow's 2nd? Your last night?
I will be in Thailand.
Yeah, tomorrow's. Well, you're going to be in Thailand. You know, I'd like to say, what a trip that's going to be, but it's in your neighborhood, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just
yeah.
right across the bay.
Yeah, very
yeah.
close.
Yeah.
Does that mean I have to do my GabNet Santa tomorrow night?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although I was thinking maybe of doing a show on Christmas Eve, but I don't know why, because nobody will be listening.
Well, it replaces the Yule log.
So let's do your Santa thing tomorrow night, and then if I
should be here, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, Bree, what are you doing in Thailand?
Here comes Richard.
Richard's doing a couple of things. Mainly, it will be a vacation, obviously. But I have to revamp an online course that I teach for a U.S. university. And I'm also going to be starting a book on radio and society in Thailand as a follow-up to the book that I wrote on Singapore radio. It's like a part of the series.
Yeah. What do they got? The top 100 in Singapore, or you know?
Did I show you my book?
No.
Let's see.
Oh wow!
I didn't know that Bree was a published author.
All right.
If I had known that, I would treat him back a little.
You have to unblur.
You got to pull back a little. No, back.
Singapore radio.
Probably has to unblur himself because.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it says Singapore radio, but it's
hard to see.
Singapore radio then and now.
Unblur yourself.
Yeah. Never mind. It's not worth mentioning.
So what was the big difference in Singapore radio? And how does it compare?
Well, you try to get a plug and then you don't use it.
Now
we're really curious.
How does Singapore radio compare to U.S. radio? And is
the difference is I could probably get a job there.
You could read the book.
Do you know Casey Kasem?
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. He's dead?
His son is very popular radio DJ in Singapore.
Wow.
Really?
Mike Kasem. Yeah.
Right.
He's been there for years. My favorite is Gene Denker, Class 95. And I have a former student who is a DJ on 987 FM. In Singapore, and one at another one, but yeah. So, no, I mean I'd say it's a mix between several countries. It's a mix. The influences, the heaviest influence is probably Australia, and the U.S. and China and Britain.
Yeah.
Talk shows.
They do have one. They used to have one called 938 Live, but now they had Radio Singapore International, but they've combined them now. They have they have their own version of sort of Al Jazeera. It's called Channel News Asia, and so they now simulcast the audio, and they have CNA 938 CNA.
So Alex CNA could do a show over there from here, from New York,
But nobody would understand a word I had to say.
They generally speaking, they don't have kind of NPR or BBC. Their radio is more an informer. It's not really a forum or a discussion place.
So they need.
Yeah, if we started talking about rectums, we'd get kicked off right away.
No, actually, you get whipped.
Caned. I think they caned.
Caned. Yeah.
Everybody
get our wankies cut caned. Off.
Get our wankies cut off? Our wankies cut off?
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, maybe they should cut off my wanky.
They have there's a lot of interesting things and that I was able to write about. But, you know, one of which is, for example, they have four national languages, but one of them would not be able to support itself on the radio without not without subsidies, you know. So they the government funds that so that they can reach that, you know, percentage of the population. You know, it's in Tamil, the Tamil language, which is an official language of Singapore. It's just not, if you had a commercial station, it probably wouldn't make it. So, you know, they fund that. And they subsidize all of the stations to a certain degree. There's, you know, they are independent, they are privatized, but in some, and they're always connected in some way to a holding company or, you know, or something else in the director who are appointed by the government. So it's not government broadcasting, but it's close to it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, maybe I'll come over there and try and get a job. I keep trying to think about, at my age, nobody will hire me. They just won't hire
Alex,
me.
You could get a job. You could.
No, I kept thinking the other day, I'd really like to make a meaningful living. You know, I'd like to make some money. And, but there's nobody that will hire me.
Walmart's hiring.
I always found that so crazy, Alex. You know, there are, in Thailand, there are sort of expat English radio stations. In Phuket, there was Tiger Radio. I don't know if that's still around. And, you know, and in Taipei, Taiwan, they have something called ICRT, which is the International Community Radio Station. And, you know, here in Malaysia, we have English stations. Singapore has English stations. All of the countries usually have some type of English presence on the radio. And you could easily work at one of those beach radio stations in Thailand.
Yeah. Well, I'm heading over there then. You know.
What do they pay? 12 baht?
Eight cents? I have to get my cancer fixed first, and then I'll come over. You know.
They'll do it very inexpensively in Thailand.
Oh, you can get your cancer fixed in Thailand. They've got medical tourism.
I don't think, you know, it's funny. I'm very lucky to be sick in New York, okay? Right. Because, and Jeff knows this because he's been in the medical profession for years.
Or Pittsburgh.
And he knows this is probably ground zero for medicine, okay?
Yeah. Depends on which area. If you have a heart or polio, you want to be in Pittsburgh.
New York.
New York Hospital? Where all that started.
I thought that DeBakey was the guy that started it down in Texas.
Yeah, I think Jonas Salk was from Pittsburgh.
That was polio.
Yeah, that was polio.
But I'm just saying that for stuff like I've got
first heart transplant.
You know, I mean,
can we look that up?
Phil was saying, DeBakey. Oh well,
that was
Phil
was the first.
Oh, it was in South Africa.
Phil was Phil was
first one. Yeah.
Phil was talking about
Bernard.
Well, that Christian Bernard. Yeah. Yes, Jeff.
My first heart surgery was done from a guy from South Africa.
Oh, really?
He came to Yale, and he was the head heart surgery.
That's there. Right. DeBakey was Christian Barnard's assistant.
Yeah.
Go home.
Yeah.
So,
that's it.
Anyway.
Yeah.
My first back surgery was by a doctor from South Africa.
I've never had surgery except for tonsils, except for my tonsils. I've never had any surgery of any sort.
Well, much circumcision.
And I don't think, but I don't think this counts as surgery either. Does it, Jeff, what I'm doing? No.
It's pretty much minimally invasive.
Yeah.
There's a small needle that they're putting in, right?
In the perineum.
Just stick them with gold.
Yeah.
It's so minimally invasive.
Where's your gold? It's up my ass.
Yeah.
I know, Alex, but, you know, if somebody were going to go, I'd rather go in Thailand than New York. Sorry.
By the way, Kathleen, are you cold tonight? You look at you.
No, you know what's nice about having a son who's like as tall as me now? I get to wear his stuff.
Patrick had his hand up. I don't know if you can see him.
Where? Patrick. Oh, Patrick. Yes, Patrick.
Put it down.
I did have it up. Well, when you were talking about South Africa, and my spinal surgery was done by an Orthodox Jew. So,
yeah,
you know. that was a failure. Yeah, it didn't work.
Well, the problem was his yarmulke got in the way, and that's why you're now not able to walk.
Well, yeah. No, I all of my surgeons that I've had have been U.S.-based and taught in the U.S., and my spinal surgeon, I believe he practiced, he had an internship and residency in New York. That's why I brought it up, because his that's where he was originally from, too.
Is he a good spinal surgeon?
Yeah, he's retired now. But I would definitely, if I had to have another surgery done and he was still practicing, I would definitely go to him, because it wasn't his anything he did that paralyzed me. It was my body's reaction.
Well, next time you talk to him, would you ask him if you walk on a crack, do you break your mother's back?
Oh, remember that? Yeah.
You do?
I was an old wise telling you. Oh, shit,
Gallbladder surgery, what William Stewart did on his mother in his sister's kitchen.
This was a relative of yours. He also did abortions on that same kitchen table. So I would just.
People did not.
Marjorie has a. They took a. A CT scan of her back, and she has a broken vertebrae. They discovered.
So you gotta fuse it?
I don't know what they're gonna. Maybe it's not a vertebrae. Something broken in her back. Hmm. And then they found
a disc or something. Jeez.
Maybe. Well,
was this from when she fell?
You know, when did she fall? I'm trying to remember.
Well,
that you know something?
That was a knee.
Remember?
But still, it's funny you should mention it, because she just noticed it in a recent CT scan, and it could be that when she took that fall, that's what happened. Excuse me, I'm going to sneeze.
Bless you. I thought it was her knee.
It was her knee.
That's when she had the surgery and all that stuff on. Yeah.
Yeah, but it could have affected the back. You don't. Yeah. That could be. Yeah. Yeah. So you know, whatever.
We have a very good orthopedic surgeon around here, and but he's a very funky guy, and his father was a surgeon like that, and his brother also, and they're very well known. But the one thing that they hate is they don't want their patients after surgery. They want them to go home and never get physical therapy or anything for a month, because they're always concerned about infection.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and just what being in the hospital. Worst place. For having an infection.
Yes.
Well, that's what
you gotta pull it back, Bree.
Yeah, it's blurred because you're
when you're that close.
Oh,
it's
blurred. Sorry.
Pull it back.
I don't think it's working. That's my other book. Presidential position.
If you unblur your background, you'll be able to see it.
Press coverage of portrayals of Clinton and Bush.
Mm.
Yeah.
You can't see it when you have your blurred background.
Is this part of your?
I am a published author.
Yeah, but is this a part of your publisher perish thing in education?
Yes.
Do you have to publish?
Yeah.
Publish or die.
Publish or perish. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have any on audio? Your book?
I was the teaching associate for Dr. Stan Alton, who wrote the book Audio and Media. So I used to, proofread some of the copy on the new editions on that. Audio and Media is considered the Bible by anybody in the audio industry.
Yeah.
He also wrote Recording Studio. Unfortunately, he passed away this year. I actually donated back to Syracuse for the first time in my life to his fund. But I never wrote anything in particular in that area. I just have written in political communication during my graduate school, and then radio, audio, media after
Yeah, I wrote a book, but I don't know if it's going to get published. It's called Trump Can Blow Me.
It's a best
I thought it was Life in the Fast Lane.
Trump Can Blow Me. But then again, he probably wouldn't want to.
Speaking of that, your boy Pete Buttigieg got attacked at the debate, I hear.
Yeah, this is what I hear, too. But, you know, he's the guy they're gunning for.
Was that gay bashing?
Yeah, right. No, he's the guy they're gunning for, because he's really getting a lot of heat lately, but I don't think any of these guys are the Trump killers. Look,
Tulsi Gabbard's taking heat back in Hawaii because she voted president.
Not even part of it anymore.
Yeah, but you know, she was the only person that really stood up. She didn't change parties, but. You know, you like her, huh?
None of them are going to win.
Patrick likes her.
Patrick likes her because he would like Tulsi Gabbard to blow him. So anyway, yeah.
And I'm surprised she voted present when she's a Russian agent, according to Hillary.
Every time
someone turns around, Buttigieg should be in a different area, like Elf on the Shelf. Like, yeah.
You gotta watch it when they turn around if Buttigieg is there.
Don't bring out that Elf on a Shelf.
You gotta be careful. Keep your hands behind you.
Yep.
I'll tell you something. He's pretty. What's all that noise?
Ooh, I don't know. That's you.
My audio settings just popped up. I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
Why did they do that?
I don't know. It's probably sucking like all the sound out of the room is what's happening. But anyway.
Buttigieg does that.
enough of the gay jokes about Buttigieg. We know he's gay. And so what?
He's gay?
Oh, I don't care about that.
I didn't know.
I just think there's nobody out there that can really do the job. I mean, the only thing you can hope for is that no matter who they nominate, he will get enough heat behind him or her that those people who are so alienated from Trump will make the difference, okay? But I wouldn't count on that. I mean, how do you feel, Kevin? You feel... Are you optimistic or pessimistic about this whole thing?
More pessimistic than anything else.
Yeah.
I haven't seen anybody that's going to jump out.
Yeah. Yeah.
No. Nobody.
Not yet.
You know what part of the problem is? I'll tell you what part of the problem is. All this happened too early. I mean, they've been out there doing the debating and the going around and politicking and everything for like 8 months now.
Yeah,
to the point where the point where we're tired of that.
Didn't the Republicans do the same thing when they weren't? No. You know, when Obama was in office, and then the Republicans came out pretty early. They had many debates. They had 19 people on the stage.
Yeah,
they had the A's and the B's.
And it became a mistake by them.
I think the Democrats would have served themselves well. By saying we're not going to start any of this politicking till like around August, September. Okay.
Who's the first Democrat to come out and run? Is he still there?
I don't know. They all kind of jumped.
Elizabeth Warren.
Was it Warren?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that was way last year, right?
Yeah.
Like towards
the
end.
She was looking
for
the Indian vote.
I have one word to describe. Elizabeth Warren tonight. when I watched the debates.
Yeah, you saw that too, right? She was starting to tear.
What were you saying? What were you saying? Yeah.
What about the prior mayor of New York?
Bloomberg.
He is, and I'm saying this, he is like the absent candidate. You just never hear anything about him. You just see all his ads on TV, but that's not any way to win an election. You got to go out there.
What is Tom Steyer doing up there?
Oh, my God. We see those commercials all the time.
Bloomberg, California.
One topic, and it's you know, defeat Trump. They have no agenda. See, the problem
Phil,
is
we don't want to hear your crap.
No, but you're talking about an empty vessel, if they have an agenda or not.
It's not getting passed.
Yes, Patrick.
I gotta say that here in Wisconsin, Bloomberg and Steyer commercial constantly, and I see nothing from anyone else. Not that I watch a lot of television, but when I record shows, you know, I see only those two, and that's it. I mean, nobody else, and I mean, it takes money, obviously, but if they're going to win in Wisconsin, they better do more than just put those two out here, you know.
Yeah, I mean, voting for Bree. Andrew Yang, folks, what's going on? This guy tells you he's going to give you $1,000 every month. Who is not voting for that? I mean, because anybody else you
because
vote
I'm
for,
holding out for $2,000.
You don't give it.
I'm not going to vote for that. I kind of like Andrew Yang, and it's not the $1,000.
Nothing.
It's the fact that he thinks Andrew Yang thinks forward. He's thinking what's going to happen when all this automation comes on board. The $1,000 a month, I think that was not the best thing to go with because you didn't understand what he wanted.
Month,
I know, but you didn't understand.
I want the $1,000. I'm not voting for him, but I want the $1,000. So just get it to me.
I'm voting for him because he'll give me $1,000, and no one else is giving me anything else.
Trump will give it to you. The check will be in the mail.
But one of his campaign promises is he will come in your mouth.
Wow. That's booted edge.
You know, one more booted edge gay joke. It just doesn't fly, Phil.
Well, you make a gay joke on Trump. You know.
I think it's already clear that it's Biden, that, you know, the Democratic Party is going to pick Biden. And
I think the fix is in.
And the reason why they're able to do it is because Sanders and Warren are splitting that niche there. If Sanders or Warren dropped out or teamed up, it'd be very hard for the Democratic Party to, you know, sort of squash them out. Yeah. But, you know, one of the things I thought was interesting I saw, and Alex won't like it because he doesn't like Cenk Uygur, but Cenk Uygur is from the Young Turks is running for Congress now. So he's technically a politician. And Bernie Sanders endorsed him, and then he had to unendorse him because Democrats got upset with, you know, what some of the things that Cenk had said earlier in his career. That is one of the reasons they caved so quick. You know, Trump, you got to hand it to him. If he, you know, he doesn't support, he'll support someone as long as they
Cenk
support
Uygur
him.
Is the kind of asshole who has a radio program and thinks that is a good reason to run for president, you know? And that's bullshit. You don't take something that you have a cachet for and try and cash that in political terms.
Trump did it.
Worked for Reagan.
It worked for Trump, but I just think it's wrong.
I agree with you.
What?
But that's why one of the reasons why the Democrats will have difficulty winning.
Yeah,
that's because their platform sucks. That's why they're going to have a difficulty winning.
Well, they're not going to get Medicare for all.
Yeah, but you don't know what their platform is yet, Phil. So how can
I know what it is? Well, I can beat Trump. No, I can beat Trump. I could beat him like a drum.
Well, the public wants somebody they feel can beat Trump. That is a major factor. I mean,
No, the left wing media wants somebody that can beat Trump. And the DNC wants somebody, but I don't think that the public wants it.
You make my head hurt. You really do.
Yeah, good.
And God knows, you know, I need every brain cell I can get now.
Yeah. Well, how many do you lose once you hit 80?
What did you say?
You start losing brain cells faster at 80, right?
Brain cells?
Brain cells, yes.
What?
All right. Good straight man.
Yeah. Well, I still am able to pretty well hold a conversation here. You know, so.
They say we're going to be able to upload our brains, you know, within 20 years. And then, you know, that cloud thing's coming in 40 years where we're all just uploaded to the cloud.
Yeah, but they'll charge $1,000 a month, you know, and then we'll have to give back all the money we get from Andrew Yang.
Yeah. Yeah.
For storage, you know.
So tomorrow,
seriously,
I think I'm going out.
Why? What are you going to get voting for anybody else? Why not just vote for Yang and hope you get
$1,000? You might get health care. You might be able to not die. Yeah. You can't.
I don't think that's coming.
Andrew Yang said you could use the $1,000 towards health care.
Good idea.
Well, the thing is, if
you can use it on whatever you
get health care the way that
I want a guaranteed $1,000.
If we get health care the way that the Republicans want it, I would be dead.
The courts ruled that the individual mandate was unconstitutional today.
Yeah, they're going to keep going after that because even in Britain now, the American health system is encroaching.
Yes, you mean your Republican Supreme Court, your loaded Supreme Court.
Thank God.
Yeah, thank God. You know, there are going to be a lot of people without health care now, Phil.
They didn't want it in the first place.
Oh,
you know, they have. You know, they could get.
Phil,
if they wanted health care, they could.
Phil,
they could buy it
without Medicare.
50,000 people can die every year.
Without Medicare and SAG-AFTRA, I would be a dead man, very shortly. Okay, so you know, we need everything we can get, and fuck the Supreme Court. They're a bunch of assholes.
Yeah.
I know what I said, Patrick, and I'm sticking to it. Mm. You see the look on Patrick's face? It was like... Anyway, so
he opened the other eye.
Shouldn't even be there. Yeah.
Well, now he won't have a big blotch in the middle of his eye vision. You know, that's great. It's great that those operations like you had used to take months to get better.
So why did they have to put the mark on the one eye that they were doing so they didn't forget and do the other eye?
Yeah, by mistake? That's right.
I do dozens of those every day.
Yeah.
I mean, if they would lose track of which eye was going to be.
Yeah, they did that with me. They did that with me. They put a piece of tape on mine.
Yeah.
Yeah, right, you know, right over the eye so they knew which one to do. Yes, Patrick.
I got the mark, and then they put a sticker as well. And the thing is, Phil, there was a lady that was in the waiting room with me. They took her like 5 minutes before me. She was holding pre-op. Then they took me. I'm talking to the nurses, and I'm having everybody laugh, and we're having a good time. She can hear me. She's chiming in. And then I'm in recovery, and I'm in my chair, and I'm having a cup of coffee, and we're... The nurses and I are talking, and this lady, the same one, walked by me, stops and says, "Thank you, Patrick, for making it such a fun time." And then she walked out, and I followed. I mean, that's how they did.
Hey, Patrick. What
it's like an assembly line.
Patrick, what did the sticker say, Trump in 2020?
No.
Yes.
It says, I voted, is what it said.
If they didn't mark his eye, next thing you know, he's got boobs.
Or he's a cyclops.
Yeah.
No, he's playing with
the boobs. Now he's playing with his. With that, we'll start bringing this to a close. I don't want to see him. Oh, God.
Oh, I'm coming.
Oh, Neil. You are a crazy bunch of motherfuckers, I gotta tell you.
Porn.
This has been a good one tonight. Kathleen, thank you so much. And of course, Charlie, great having you here. Phil, as always. Tony, thank you. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Patrick. And thank you, Bree. Why have you got your ears closed? You're trying not to hear him play with his breasts? Anyway, everybody. Everybody, give a big wave goodbye, and I'll give a big wave goodbye back to you, okay? There we go. There they go, ladies and gentlemen. That's our citizen panel for tonight. Tomorrow night be the last citizen panel of the year. So you might want to actually get in on that in some way, shape, or form. Jack Bishop is next. He's here with The Intersection. And I'll be back again tomorrow night right after Damien Chaplin. does his little thing at 9:30 called the Exchange. I'm Alex Bennett, and I will see you at 10 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time. Same time, same station in life. And in the meantime, if you see her, yeah, tell her I love her, okay? Bye, everybody.